You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. Good afternoon. Just wanted to welcome you all. Today we're going to be talking about LWAP, which is life without parole, especially for minors. We're going to be talking about public opinion, and we'll more than likely go into political parties. But before we get started, I do want to thank all the students who have done their survey, their introductory survey. I've read a lot about it, and I really found it very interesting to see that a lot of students are planning on pursuing a graduate education. So I applaud you all for pursuing that, and I'm glad to have you here in this course. Also, too, I've noticed that there's quite a few students that have been doing the discussion blog, the discussion post, on the death penalty. So continue working on that, and then we also have other assignments as well. And we do have an abortion survey up. If you have not yet done so, make sure you complete that, because that will be most integral to this course, especially to this session, because we will be talking about public opinion on abortion. So if you'd like to participate in today's session, you can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So last week we were talking about political principles. So we were talking about the foundation of our government and how we borrowed from various countries. And we're also talking about our rights. Now, as you recall, our first 10 amendments to the Constitution are our Bill of Rights. So we talked about our First Amendment, our freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of the media, Amendment number 2, our right to bear arms, Amendment 3, quartering of soldiers, Amendment 4, against unreasonable searches and seizures, Amendment number 5, double jeopardy, Amendment number 6, the right to have a speedy trial, Amendment number 7, the right to have a juror, Amendment number 8 has to do with against excessive bailing and cruel and unusual punishment, and Amendment number 9 and 10 are reserved rights to the states. Now, as you recall, Amendment number 8 on cruel and unusual punishment is actually very key, especially when we talk about the discussion on the death penalty and for today's topic, life without parole. Now, if you were aware of it or not, in our country, if somebody committed an act, a criminal act, prior to the age of turning 18 years old, if it was a heinous crime, that individual can be sent to a prison and will never see the day of light outside, meaning that it's life without parole, meaning that there's no guarantee that they'll ever be able to come out or have their case ever heard. Now, there have been studies, especially neuroscience, has shown that the brain hasn't yet matured, especially when kids are adolescents. They have not yet matured fully. So some of the decisions that they have made, there were decisions that were kind of influenced by their peers. It really had to do with them. A lot of times when young teenagers, young juveniles commit crimes, they're usually in groups instead of being on their own. So it comes to this with life without parole. Now, recently here in California, there was a bill that was introduced. It was called SB 9. Now, whenever there's a bill that's introduced here in California, it could be either the Assembly or the State Senate, which is the Assembly bill, it would be AB or SB, Senate Bill number 9. And we're gonna talk more about legislation as we go over the semester, and especially when we talk about California politics. So, it's a Senate bill, SB 9. It was called the Fair Sentencing for Youth Act. Now, this bill was introduced by Senator Leland Yee. He is from San Francisco. He's from San Francisco, and he actually introduced this bill quite a few times. This is a bill that a lot of legislatures and also advocacy members were working on for at least six years until it finally passed. So this bill is actually passed, and it has been written into law, which is a good thing. But before that, let's talk about SB number 9. Okay, so a lot of advocacy groups, and me myself, I was one of the people working on this bill when I was working as a lobbyist in Sacramento. And usually before we introduce a bill, what happens is we do a survey. We do kind of a poll to see where do people stand on this issue. And we found that 81% of people agreed that youth should not have to spend the rest of their lives in prison. And that also life without parole doesn't reduce crime. And that individuals can change. People deserve to have a second chance. And that's what we hope for. And this bill required that after 15, 20, 25 years, depending on the person's status, after they have done their time in prison, they can petition to have their case reviewed by the court. And this has to do with, you know, how well a person's behavior is in prison, if they have been doing well, you know, have they been communicating with their family and not their, you know, friends that are into crime. So they do have to meet some type of certain criteria before, you know, they can be eligible to have their case reviewed. So this is Fair Sentencing for Youth Act SB 9. And also to this bill, it doesn't guarantee a person to be eligible for parole. So they have to earn it. So if they have earned it and, you know, the courts have deemed that person should receive it, it's more than likely that they hopefully can get it as long as they serve their time in prison. So they still have, no matter what, this bill, it allows that the youth has to serve at least 25 years in prison. So there's this law, as I mentioned, SB 9, it came about because there are individuals who are in prison, young individuals, who committed crimes at certain points in their life because of certain situations, certain mitigating factors. Now, one of the situations that I wanted to take a look at is from Sarah Krizan. Let's take a look at her story and how this affects her. Let's take a look at that video.
School, I excelled. I was on the honor roll and the principal's honor roll, and I was like an overachiever. I ran track, I ran for student body president. I wrote a book on drugs and its effects, and I won a Young Authors Award. Gigi would start to take me or my little friends to the roller skating or to the mall and stuff and everything. And he was like a father figure. Gigi was there at some times. And he would talk to me and take me out and like give me all these lavish gifts or do all these things for me and stuff. And then he would tell me that sex-wise, he said, you don't need to give it up for free. He would try to put in my head all these different things and how men really think and how men are. And so I would believe him. He had sex with me when I was 13. And he's a very... he uses his manhood to hurt, like break you in, I guess. Gigi's hours were from 6 in the evening to about 5:30 to 6 in the morning. The girls would bring their money and give it to him and stuff. He was like married to all of us, I guess. That's just how they do. Everything was his. The judge sat up there, and I remember my lawyer saying that he wanted to ask for me to be sentenced as a juvenile because YA had found me amenable and susceptible to the treatment. But the judge said that because of my crime, and he said it was a well thought out, that I deserved the life without. That means I'm gonna die here. I'm very sorry to take his life like that. I definitely know I deserve punishment. I mean, you don't just take somebody's life and think that it's okay. So yes, definitely deserve punishment. How much? I don't know. I've always tried to educate myself, though, as far as reading books and things like that, but I didn't think I could excel, you know? And who wants to excel in prison? I mean, be all you can be, it's not much. I guess my little heart would tell me that I was worth more. My judge had told me I lacked moral scruples, and I understand that. I had no clue what morals were, and I had no clue what scruples meant. So I had to find that in a dictionary and put the two together, you know, so integrity or, you know, honesty and all these things that I needed to learn, I went ahead and started to build this. If I had a parole hearing, I would want to tell the people that, first of all, I've learned what moral scruples are. Second, that, every day is a challenge, but I realized that I'm nervous. That I found the ability to believe in myself, and that I have a lot of good to offer. Now, the person who I am today at 29, I believe that I could set a positive example. I'm very determined to show that no matter what you've done or where you've come from or what you've experienced in life, it's up to you to change.
Yes, and if you're interested in learning more about Sarah Kuzan's story, I know they developed a website in her name, and also if you're on Facebook, I know you can also add her and her movement on Facebook as well. So, talking about life without parole, now what do you think about that? Do you think minors should have to be sent to life without parole, or should they deserve a second chance? Now, how do you feel about that? I would welcome your opinions. If you can, please call at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Also, too, what about the death penalty? How do you feel about the death penalty? Should individuals who commit a crime be sentenced to death, or should they just be sitting on skid row? So how do you feel about that, on death row, excuse me? So we have the death penalty, we have life without parole. Now, this issue about SB 9, eventually it was passed, thankfully, in 2012. It was signed by our Governor Brown, and it was sentenced, so it was signed into law, excuse me. But before I go any further, I wanted to give you some more statistics about this, because as I mentioned, before anything gets considered into law, we want to know what the people feel and how they think about this issue. So nationally, 59% of juveniles sentenced to life without parole. Usually what happens is those people are first-time offenders. 59% of the offenders that are sentenced to life without parole are first-time offenders. And usually, according to Human Rights Watch, they estimate that 45% of youth offenders serving life without parole when they were convicted of murder are usually not the ones who actually commit the murder. It's somebody else. So they just happen to be at the wrong place at the wrong time. Also, too, prior to 2012, the United States was the only country in the world to have had this, to send minors to life in prison with no second chance of parole. So just some facts about this. Now, in 2012 was very landmark because the Supreme Court took one of the cases, which was called Miller versus Alabama, and also interpreted that with the Constitution, with Amendment Number 8 about cruel and unusual punishment. So now, after 2012, states are no longer to send youth to life without parole. So that's a landmark case, and a lot of people are very happy about that. So I just wanted to point to your attention how each state has interpreted that law since then. So if I can have your attention over here to the screen here on my computer. Thank you very much. So life without parole for juveniles, as I mentioned, since 2012, the Miller versus Alabama case was heard by the Supreme Court, so no longer states are sentencing minors to life without parole, but each state has their own way of interpreting it. So let's take a look at Arkansas. It says that capital murders under age 18 must serve a mandatory 28 years in prison before they're eligible for parole. And they can also be sentenced up to life without parole. Okay, let's look at California, because that's where we're at here. Life without parole is not an option for any youth offenders, and a parole review is required for existing offenders after 15, 20, and 25 years. As I mentioned, SB 9 did help in that legislation about the 15, 20, and 25 years. So each state has interpreted differently, but luckily here in our country, that is no longer allowed. It is now illegal to send a minor to life without parole. So that's a landmark case. So I'd be looking forward to hearing your comments and opinions about this. And what I'd like to do is, we saw one side, right? Now let's take a look at another side. Let's take a look at the victim's family members about SB 9. So let's take a look at this video about speaking from pain.
I always smile when I think of her because she was a really joyful person. She was just the kind of older sister that you would sort of, I would imagine anyone would want.
Pues era una muchacha muy alegre en sus momentos, le gustaba andar haciendo chistes. Bailando, brincando.
No sé, era mi primera hija, la más grande, entonces era, era todo para mí, eran muchas emociones.
The Damon Dadrian Dow. He was a funny son, funny, always had a full of jokes. At 3:30 in the morning, the phone rang, and it was, they said they were from the medical examiner. And he said, well, we have Damon with us, and Damon has been killed.
She worked with adolescents and young adults, and she had a client who was mentally ill, and she invited him to come in and talk about it, and you know, because he was really upset about it. And so he did come in, but he came in with a gun, and he shot my sister and three other women, and they all died.
En el momento en que ella se fue, es como quitarle una esquina a un edificio, tratarlo de tirar.
And when they told me who the suspect was, I was totally floored. I said, no, it's not. You have the wrong person. And they said, well, his name is Dante Carruthers. He's just turned 17.
Estaba con la policía, lo tenían abajo, esposado. En el... Y le pregunté por qué había hecho eso. El ver en sus ojos de él la reacción que volteaba a ver a los policías y les decía, no es cierto, no es cierto, ella no está muerta. ¿Verdad que todos están bien? ¿Ella está bien?
The boy that murdered my son has a sentencing of life without parole plus 15 years. He'll never see the street again. The way it sounds from here, he'll die in prison.
I've given a lot of thought to the issue of life without parole for young people, for adolescents. And it seems so important to me that people understand that a young person, an adolescent, is not a fully formed person yet.
No creo que por ser hacer cosas de mayores mentalmente sean piensen como adultos. Creo que es la etapa de la inmadurez donde creen que pueden comerse a lo mejor el mundo.
Kids are kids, and their lifestyles and the things that they grow up with and see may have something to do with why they do the things that they do, because they absolutely don't understand life, period.
Entonces, verle en la parte de atrás, su vida que han llevado atrás, respecto a su vida que hayan llevado, es también juzgarlos, no nada más en la primera.
Life without chance of parole for these young people is devastating.
Es la juventud, es el futuro de la del mundo, entonces sería mejor enfocar en ayudarlos.
I want young people in California to have the opportunity to know that there is hope, that if they change themselves, if they transform their lives, if they take responsibility for the harm that they've done, that they have the hope that one day they could leave prison and be connected again with their community and their loved ones.
Because of what I do, I can see me supporting SB9.
Yo apoyo sentencias justas para los jóvenes.
Okay, so before we went into the video, I asked everybody who's watching the question is, do you support SB9, the Fair Sentencing for Youth Act, should juvenile offenders who have committed a crime be allowed a second chance or not? And also, too, how do you feel about the death penalty as well? So you can call 1-800-339-1193, or you can email your responses to askdhtv@gmail.com. And just to remind you that we are recording live here in the South Bay, here at Cal State Dominguez Hills in the city of Carson. So I welcome all your comments and opinions. Now, before we go into students' comments, I do want to note that the situation that Sarah was in, she was in a very difficult situation. She had a mother who was on drugs. She didn't have a mother figure in her life, and the only person who was there for her was her pimp, Gigi, who she ended up killing, which is very unfortunate. But that person, Gigi, had ended up luring her into the crime of prostitution and as well as sex trafficking. So it's very unfortunate. And in her situation, when I look at her story, I kind of feel, this is my own personal opinion, I kind of feel like she had no way out, and I think that's why she did what she did. I know there could have been other circumstances for her to get out of that, but in the situation that she was in and how she was brought up and what she'd been through, she felt that was the only way out and it was wrong. But with this new law, you know, now she's eligible to actually be eligible for parole and get out. So let's go to the comments. This is from Abigail. Thank you, Abigail. And this Abigail says, I can't believe that Sarah Cruzan was out on life without parole. Yes, she committed a crime, but in doing so, she freed not only herself, but countless others from a horrible life of sex trafficking. Yes, and that is correct. Thank you, Abigail. I have some more comments. Okay, this is from Katie. So many sad stories of youth committing crimes. Most of them do not have a positive role model and they need rehabilitation. It's someone who truly cares to work with them. Life in jail won't always help. Let's go to the next part. Okay, I guess that was all. Thank you, Katie. And this is from Rodrigo. Okay, Rodrigo says, it depends on the crime. Also the state of mind, the mental condition of the young person. So yes, so great. I have some great comments. I would greatly appreciate for you to either call or text in your comments as well. during this podcast. So as I mentioned, SB 9 was signed into law, so individuals who did commit a crime are now eligible for parole after they had done at least 15, 20, or 25 years in prison. And also on a nationwide level, the Supreme Court also ruled that it is now illegal for states to sentence minors to life without parole after 2012. So we are making progress into that, and so it's very good news to learn. So what you've been seeing is life without parole, but what I'm asking you to do is also to formulate your own public opinion, because that's what we're going to be going to next. What is public opinion? Okay? So public opinion, basically, it's defined as the distribution of citizens' opinions on matters of public concern or interest. Once again, public opinion is defined as the distribution of citizens' opinions on matters of public concern or interest. So we're looking for information that tells us what people think and matters relating to politics and society. So public opinion is actually very important, because I'm interested in what you think, and also if anyone decides to run for elected office, getting information from polls to gather public opinion is very important, depending on what issues you stand for and whether if that person's going to win in an elected race or not. So public opinion is associated with public culture, political culture, and also political socialization. And one of the assignments that we have coming up for this week is writing about the agents of socialization, which we're going to be going to into this next segment. So public opinion, how do you feel about an issue? And where do you stand on that issue, which I just had you do just recently? You know, do you support SB 9 or do you don't? Do you support the death penalty, yes or no? So what you're doing there is you're formulating your public opinion on how you feel about an issue. So how do you form your political views? So people differ. People differ based on their age, based on their gender, based on their race, based on their income, and based on their location. So people find that, do people change their views, you know, when they get educated or they get a job or they get married, they have a family, they retire, they're of old age. So do poor people who get rich in adult life change their political views and vice versa? So here we're truly trying to figure out is public opinion, how do we follow that? So public opinion is also political socialization. And forming public opinion, which are the agents of socialization, are either direct contact or secondary contact. So persons such as your parents, your family members, your friends, your coworkers, maybe something that you saw in the media, also different types of settings that this could influence the way you think about politics. It could be in your home. It could be at your church, it could be at your school, it could be where you work at, your workplace. Maybe you're affiliated with some type of clubs at school or in the community. That can also influence how you feel about politics. Also unions, if any of you are working right now and are participating within a union, that may also to influence how you feel about politics, as well as any other types of professional associations. So before I go any further, I have some more comments here. This is from Michaela. Michaela Coleman, thank you very much. I noticed I do have two Michaelas in this class. Thank you very much for putting your last name. This is Michaela's comment. It depends on the crime. As far as Sarah Cruzan, her sentence is overboard. Although if there was a teen who committed multiple crimes, death without parole is acceptable. Okay, so we're talking about your public opinion on SB 9, which is minors who are sentenced to life without parole, which is called the Fair Sentencing Youth Act, because we want to change that. And so MASCE students, all of you who are tuned in, how do you feel about that? So thank you very much, Michaela. So thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, so going back into public opinion. So, you know, how do we form public opinion? Who are your agents of socialization? So you may want to tune into this and listen and focus on this, because this is something I'm going to be asking for your assignment. So like I said, your agents of socialization could be your parents, your teachers, your friends, your coworkers, the media. Now, there's different types of settings where you can get this information from. It could be within your home or in the workplace, as well as you have two different types of groups. You have what is called the primary group, and then you also have the secondary group. So your primary group are people who you see every day. So it's face-to-face contact on a regular basis. Could be your friends, your coworkers, your family, etc. And your secondary group is more broad. So these people you don't see very often, but they do have some type of influence on what you feel about public opinion and how you formulate your opinion. So this could be within your church, within the union, and groups of interest, such as there are many interest groups that are out there. And we're going to be talking more about interest groups as we go further in the semester. So you have what is called the Greenpeace. You have the National Rifle Association, also known as the NRA. You have the Chamber of Commerce, American Red Cross, and the Human Rights Watch. We just talked about Human Rights Watch a little bit earlier because they were the ones who were advocating for SB9, for the Fair Sentencing for Youth Act. So what other types of secondary groups that are out there? Who else influences your opinion on political issues? So if we were to think about the media also too affects your public opinion, which we're actually going to be going into in just a moment. Thank you very much. So before we go into the media, I want to take a look at a video about public opinion on legalizing marijuana. So how do you feel about legalizing marijuana? And as you know, here in the United States, there are two states that have legalized it, in Colorado and as well as in Washington. So how do you feel about legalizing pot, especially here in California or on a state, on a nationwide level? So let's take a look at that video.
Reefer madness, the Woodstock generation, the rampant use of weed during Vietnam, the war, and medical marijuana as well. These are all integral parts of the decades-old debate over whether pot should be legal across the United States. A majority of Americans have always been adamant, no, do not legalize pot. Until now. For the first time since it began polling on the issue more than 40 years ago, the Pew Research Center is finding that a majority of Americans now favors legalizing marijuana, 52-45. Pew says the support for making pot legal has absolutely soared since 2010. In fact, it has soared 11 points. And this poll shows the big push is from young people. Also, more than half of boomers are now favoring legalizing marijuana. Right now, here is the state of pot in the United States. 18 different states plus the District of Columbia have chosen to legalize pot for medical use. Two of those states, Colorado and Washington State, have approved it for recreational use as well. That happened during the 2012 election. And joining us now for their take on the sea change in public opinion on the legalization of pot and if it will make any difference at all, CNN legal analyst Jeffrey Toobin, who joins us by phone, and then in San Francisco, Ethan Nadelman of the Drug Policy Alliance, which advocates for the legalization of pot. Mr. Nadelman, let me begin with you. We've seen this before, where generations of people change and attitudes change and then laws follow shortly thereafter. They change. Do you expect that will be the case here?
Well, it's definitely going to be the case, Ashley. You know, back in the late 70s, people thought we were on the verge of decriminalization or legalization of marijuana. But back then, barely a third of Americans were in favor, and most of the older generation were not baby boomers. They didn't know the difference between marijuana and heroin. Now you're seeing this Pew poll, Gallup polls, a whole range of others consistently showing a small majority of Americans in favor. So what happened in Washington and Colorado during the last election is going to happen again in other states around the country. In the same way that medical marijuana was legalized either through the initiative process or the legislative process in 18 states to date, we're going to see that same thing happening with the broader legalization of marijuana.
Let me bring in Jeffrey Toobin on this. You know, a lot of people make the case about same-sex marriage and that attitudes change with regard to same-sex marriage, and the states shortly started changing as well. There have been a number of states, I think we're at 9 now, that allow same-sex marriage. And yet, there is this wisdom out there that drugs are different, that marijuana is different, that this isn't maybe a civil rights issue that other people think it is. Do you see the argument there as being apples and oranges?
Well, there is a parallel, but there's also a very important difference. With same-sex marriage, the federal government cannot and does not prohibit states from allowing same-sex marriage. There's the Defense of Marriage Act, which limits certain benefits for gay couples who are married, but they certainly don't prohibit it. What makes marijuana different and frankly unpredictable in how it will work is that even though Washington and Colorado have voted to legalize marijuana, it is still a federal crime to possess marijuana. And how federal and state law interacts as those states move towards legalization, I think, is the really big question that's unresolved at this point.
Help me answer that question, or at least get as close as you can to an answer, Jeffrey. Do you think that maybe the polls that are out there and the growing support for legalizing marijuana for recreational or medicinal purposes may have an effect on whether the feds decide to ever prosecute any state where it's legal?
Well, I think that is a process that is unfolding. I don't think the political support for legalization is anywhere near the level where you would have Congress simply repeal the federal marijuana laws, but there is an ongoing negotiation process between those states and the federal government about how they will prosecute it. But frankly, I mean, maybe Ethan knows better than I do, but I don't know how the federal and state laws will interact as these states move to legalize. It's really a difficult question.
Ethan, I know you make this your daily work.
Yeah. Well, I'll tell you, Ashley, I mean, Jeffrey's exactly right. What's going on right now is that the governors of Washington and Colorado, Inslee and Hickenlooper, have asked the Justice Department, Attorney General Holder, and the White House, give us a chance to implement these new laws.
And
Holder is obviously struggling with what to do right here. Now, here's the real dilemma, which is that the feds, to say to these governors in these two states, yes, go ahead, we're going to give you a qualified green light to implement these laws, is the right thing in terms of public safety, public health, finance, responsible regulation, regulating marijuana like alcohol. If, on the other hand, the feds say, no way, federal law just trumps, that's it, we're not going to let you do this, then what's going to happen is it's not like marijuana is going to go away. It's still going to be produced and sold, but it's all going to continue to be illegal. It'll all be in the hands of the criminals. And what that means from my perspective as an activist is that when we see the next wave of ballot initiatives coming up and legislation around the country, instead of doing these kind of responsible regulatory models to tax and regulate marijuana, the alternative is going to be to do what Americans did in the late 1920s and early 1930s with alcohol prohibition, which is to repeal the state marijuana prohibition laws and just say to the feds, if you want to enforce these laws, go ahead and try.
Remains to be seen whether that's the pattern that will be followed, but I can say this. There are a lot of people out there who disagree with you and say it's not a safety issue at all. In fact, or it is a safety issue, but not for the reasons that you say. You and I are going to have more conversations on this, Ethan Nadelman.
No, I know,
thanks
but
so
from
much
a rational perspective, you want to regulate this, not criminalize it.
It depends on what you consider rational. I have to leave it there, but thank you so much for being with us.
Okay, good. So we're talking about public opinion. And how do you feel about certain issues, various issues? We talked about LWAP, death penalty, and now we're going into how do you feel about legalization of marijuana. Now, I have a comment here. This is from Rodrigo. Rodrigo says, pot should be legal. It will take away the drug out of the young hands and stop black market drugs because of the general store selling pot would be brought there. Okay, thank you very much, Rodrigo, for your opinion. And you can also call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com on how you feel about public opinion and as well as about legalizing marijuana or about the other issues that we've been discussing on this program. Now, this is from Katie. I think most young people form their public opinions based on their peers' influence. I think that many of them do not take time to investigate things for themselves or form their own opinions. Okay, good. Very, very well. I agree with you, Katie. I think a lot of individuals do need to research on what's going on out there. So thank you, Katie. And I think I have another comment. Let's see. Are there any more comments out there? Okay, like I said, you could call in or you could ask dhtv@gmail.com on how you feel about certain issues. Now, we'll take a look at, we're talking about ages of socialization, right? So who influences you on how you feel about certain issues? Now, I was getting to the point about the media. So there are secondary groups of agents of socialization. Now, social media is definitely a secondary group. Now, we have YouTube. Everybody goes onto YouTube, a great way to look at videos or watch movies or etc. Twitter is another way as well. Facebook, a lot of people were on Facebook, and also Pinterest and Instagram and Vine, and there's so many other different types of social media that comes out there that individuals hear about and that they want to join them and participate in them. So also too, what you see on YouTube or what you see on Twitter, you know, there's so many social media applications that are out there that can also too influence you on how you form your public opinion. And also pollsters and marketing strategists and marketers, they use this information to see how you feel about certain issues and how they could get you involved into their political campaigns, depending on who's watching it. So we talked about the various, there's various interest groups that also influence individuals to think about a certain issue. And there's also the NRA, which is the National Rifle Association. And since of what has been happening, this is the group that advocates to, for individuals to have gun rights. But since what has been happening recently in our country, individuals are against that. And so why don't we take a look at a video from protesters disrupting an NRA press conference. Oh, you know what? Before we get to that, let's take a look at Facebook better. Let's take a look at Facebook, how Facebook gets political. Let's take a look at that video and how social media influences your public opinion.
My name is Barack Obama, and I'm the guy who got Mark to wear a jacket and tie.
As a company, Facebook is no stranger to the political scene. In April, founder Mark Zuckerberg hosted a town hall with the president at the company's headquarters. In February, he joined the CEOs of Yahoo and Google, among others, for an intimate dinner with the president. They have also sponsored events with Republicans, including New Jersey Governor Chris Christie and three top House Republicans. The Center for Responsive Politics says Facebook spent $910,000 on lobbying this year, more than twice as much as in 2010.
They're getting ahead of the curve. They have a strong Washington lobbying presence. And now they're putting together a PAC so that they can influence policies that affect them on Capitol Hill.
The social networking site formed a political action committee in September, explaining that it would allow employees to contribute to candidates who share our goals of promoting the value of innovation to our economy while giving people the power to share and make the world more open and connected. Among the issues of concern to Facebook, privacy, cybersecurity, and intellectual property. So what does this new PAC mean for 2012?
Sounds like they're going to be very bipartisan in what they do, and they're going to support policies that support Facebook, not necessarily Republicans, not necessarily Democrats, but it looks like it's going to be a big bipartisan effort, which is really smart in this town.
Still, GOP hopeful Michelle Bachmann had this to say today in an interview with an Iowa radio station.
I think that we've seen, without a shadow of a doubt, whether it is the head of Facebook or the head of Google, it's been very clear that there's been an alliance with the Obama administration.
The company denies any such alliance. When it comes to presidential politics, it's worth noting that the Obama campaign does not accept PAC money.
Now, Candy, Facebook has been slowly building up its roster of politically connected employees, adding former Clinton spokesman Joe Lockhart to its communications team, along with former Obama staffer Sarah Feinberg and Tucker Bounds, a former press aide to John McCain's 2008 campaign. Another big name, former Clinton aide Erskine Bowles, who joined the company's board.
Okay, so Facebook gets political, and they're not the only organization that is out there, social media. There are other ones that also get political, and also for someone who's running for elected office, those types of outlets are very important for someone to be active on Twitter or active on Facebook, and so they are engaging with their fans or they're engaging with their community members. So those types of social media applications are very important. So social media and media itself can definitely influence your public opinion depending on how you feel about a certain issue, and also depending on, you know, your age, your race, your gender, you know, where you're located, your income, all those other factors definitely play a role on influencing your public opinion. Now, one of the groups that I did want to take a look at before anything is, I want to take a look at the NRA, the National Rifle Association. I wanted to take a look at this and how protesters disrupt the NRA press conference, because like I was mentioning, NRA advocates for gun rights, and what has been happening in our country lately is there's been a lot of severe massacres, individuals killing other people with the use of guns. And so this has brought to question about how do we deal with gun rights. But there is an organization that advocates for gun rights, and as you know, there are individuals who are against it. So how you feel about, you know, should people have the right to bear arms or should they not? So let's take a look at this video about the protesters disrupting the NRA press conference.
To our most beloved, innocent, and vulnerable members of the American family, our children, we as a society leave them every day utterly defenseless. And the monsters and the predators of the world know it and exploit it. That must change now. The truth is, NRA, stop killing our children. It's the NRA and the assault weapons that are killing our children. Rather than face their own moral failings, the media demonize gun owners.
Yes, that's pretty deep. That was very intense. So as you can see, protesters are against the NRA because they feel they have they're the ones to blame when it comes to gun rights and gun laws. So just to show you the differences on public opinion. So to go further, when we talk about public opinion, we also relate this to political parties. We're talking about political parties a little bit further in the semester, maybe probably at the end of the session. If not, we'll talk about it into next week. But just a note is that individuals highly identify with their parents on their political beliefs and their public opinion. So they have shown that at least 60 to 65% of individuals do side with their parents about their political party and as well as about their public opinion. Also, too, other things that help formulate opinions about politics, especially and on the educational level, is taking courses in civics, social studies, government, political science, as you are here, can also help formulate your public opinion on issues. And also, too, where you work at can also definitely influence on how you think about political issues. Other ways we gather public opinion is from the internet, as I mentioned, also from the news, when we watch the news in the evening or at the morning, and also the radio. And I do have a comment here. This is from Rodrigo. Thank you very much, Rodrigo. Rodrigo says, I do not believe guns are the problem, but the failing mental health care because of cutbacks in mental health care. So that's what Rodrigo said. Okay, good. Okay, guns are not the problem, but the failing mental health care is. And I also agree with you on that about the mental health care, because I do feel that a lot of those individuals who did that had mental issues, and they definitely needed to be remedied. And unfortunately, they didn't get remedied in time. So if we're able to pick up on those types of signals, especially people who live with those people who had those types of issues, and able to seek appropriate assistance, and, you know, be able to get mental health assistance for that person, I think that could help a whole lot. So hopefully there will be some type of policies that are going to be introduced soon that deal with the issue of mental health, because I do also agree with you that that is a big factor on that. Okay, good. So why don't we take a break? Let's take a 5-minute break, and then we'll return and continue to discuss public opinion.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to planetary science and astronomy class at California State University, Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California, not just the United States, but the world. And I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world. And to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers. And this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind. And it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
My name is Zenea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
This is my university.
Hey, Mark, nice paper.
This student life.
I'm home right now, but.
Sweet!
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, so we're back. Okay, so we're talking about public opinion. Why don't we talk a little bit more about polling? Because polling is also another aspect of measuring your public opinion and how you feel about certain issues. So just a brief historical background of polling is, initially, there was this company called the Literary Digest from 1916 to 1932. And what they would do is they would call individuals based on their phone book, based on phone books, and also based on car registrations on how they felt about certain issues. Unfortunately, when it came to the election in 1936, when it came to the election of Roosevelt versus Alf Landon, they actually oversampled Roosevelt and they felt that Alf Landon was going to win the presidential election. And as you know, you may not have heard of Alf Landon because he obviously did not win, but you have heard about our former president, Roosevelt. So Roosevelt was actually reelected and the Literary Digest ended up no longer being in existence. However, during that same year, an individual named George Gallup also created a public opinion polling and was able to accurately identify Roosevelt as the new president of the United States. And today we still have what is called the Gallup polls, and you can actually go to the website at gallup.com and you can see how they go about measuring public opinion. And also during that time, when it was a depression and also Roosevelt's new deal policies, a lot of votes from the poor people differed from the wealthy people during that time for the New Deal policies. So just a little historical background about public opinion and especially about polling. And there's different types of polls, but before we go into that, why don't we take a look at some comments? Okay, this is from Gabby. Okay, the topic of gun violence is a difficult one, and to be completely honest, I fall right in the middle of both sides. The fortunate reality is that if one person really wants to shoot someone dead, they will. Okay, thank you, Gabby. Thank you for your comment. And anybody else who would like to comment, you can either call 1-800-339-1193 or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So polling. So there's different types of polls. And there's actually companies out there that will do polling for you if you decide to run for elected office. And as I mentioned, the overview of polling, usually calling someone, they use a series of closed-ended questions and usually designed with, in consultation with the client, and they choose a random sample of people to contact over the telephone. And so the purpose of polling is to help you develop and deliver a message that will reach the public or organization members and help move them into that direction. And also to build support among members and the general public by releasing polling results to show support for your organization and positions. So there's what is called is a benchmark poll. The benchmark poll is an initial poll and the beginning of a campaign or beginning of a project, usually to measure the message or the strategy. And there are also preference polls. These polls ask someone, hey, who do you prefer to vote for? And there's also opinion surveys, how do you feel about a certain issue? And there's also focus groups. Focus groups is when they get a group of 10 or 15 people into a room and they ask them, how do they feel about a certain situation? There's also what is called the tracking poll. Tracking polls interview several hundred new people a day, and then the average of samples over the last 2 to 3 days to get an accurate result of what is going on in a race, as well as exit polls. Exit polls is, let's say you go vote for someone in an election, and once you leave that poll, somebody will come up to you and ask you a bunch of questions. That is what is called an exit poll. Now, why don't we take a look at some polls, especially about Obama's performance. Let's take a look at that. So for Obama's performance, thank you very much. And these numbers actually come from, is it Quinnipiac University in Massachusetts? And they found that for President Obama in March 2009, what his job performance rating is. So 62% of people approved of President Obama's job performance, 28% of individuals disapproved, and 10% had no opinion. Now, as you know, President Obama is in his second term, and there has been talk about former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton be running for his position fairly soon. So why don't we take a look at the polls and how they feel about having a female president such as Hillary Clinton. Okay, there we go. So public opinion, likely voters for Hillary Clinton. This was actually taken just recently, just last month. So 58% of individuals are favorable of having Hillary Clinton as our next president. And there's actually 38% that are unfavorable of having Ms. Hillary Clinton as our president, and 4% that are undecided. So I'd be very interested in knowing, how do you feel about President Obama's performance as our president, and how do you feel about having Hillary Clinton as our next president and will be our first woman president of the United States? So how do you feel about that? If you can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. So we're talking about the different kinds of polls. There's different types of polls that exist. I mentioned the benchmark poll, as well as the tracking poll. But nowadays, polls are getting a little bit more difficult to actually gather because the use of answer machines. A lot of people do not tend to answer the phone nowadays. They just let it go to the answer machine. So that kind of prevents a pollster to call you to see where you stand on an issue. Also, the use of caller ID. Caller ID, if you don't know the number, you may not want to pick up. Also, too, a lot of times when people register for vote, they put their home phone number. But nowadays, everybody's on their cell phone. Everybody's, on their cell phone. So when people call their home number, no one's there. So they have no way of gathering that opinion. And also, too, sometimes when individuals call their home to participate, some people do not want to participate. They'll just hang up and not want nothing to do in giving their opinion. So just to know, it has been difficult on getting polling information from individuals because of these certain aspects that have came into place as machines, caller ID, and also people's unwillingness to participate. Now, I have a comment here. This is from Paige. Paige says, do polls take into consideration that some people will not tell the truth? Yes, they do have what is called a sampling error. So a sampling error, they have it either up 3 or minus 3%. So if they were to sample about 1,000 people, they do have what is called a sampling error, which is 3% either plus or minus. So they do take the result of a sampling error that people may not be telling the truth when they go ahead and they give opinions. So any data is good data, that's what we usually say, but definitely do want to take into consideration the sampling error of that data set. So yes, thank you very much, Paige. So going into polling, there's also what is called push polls. And a push poll is not a real poll, but is actually designed to influence voters by providing negative false information. Now, I just want to share with you a situation that happened in 2012, a few years ago, 2 years ago, on somebody in my district was running for state assembly and somebody else was running against that person. So what they were doing, the person who was running against the person that I was supporting, they would call my house as well as neighbors and they were doing a push poll. So they were telling us negative information about this candidate so that we would not vote for this person, and which is not right, and I knew it wasn't right, but this person decided to do that and invest money in a push poll. So they'll call a bunch of people and say bad things about a candidate for elected office so that you or someone else would not vote for that person. So that had happened. Also too, they had what is called a preference poll. So they would call up people in the community and ask them, hey, who are you gonna vote for? And if you tell them, then they're like, oh, okay, this person's gonna vote for so-and-so. And so then what they would do is they take that information, and if that person is against that candidate, they would dump more information into like flyers, handouts, into commercials, into handouts, so they could try to sway that opinion to the other side. So these polls are actually really important, especially when it comes to somebody who's running for elected office, on how they go about gathering information and also to understand where do people stand on certain issues. Yeah, so polling is very important. So what polls tell us is that when we take a look at polls, it says that lower class children have usually less information about politics than middle class and upper class individuals. And also in the 2008 election, for people who voted for Obama, they said about 95% of black people voted for Obama, 67% of Hispanics voted for Obama, and 43% of white individuals had voted for Obama. Also, two polls tell us that Hispanics and Asian Americans are the fastest growing racial and ethnic minority in the nation, as well as Chinese, Filipino, Indians, Japanese, and Koreans lean more towards the Democratic Party, while Vietnamese lean more toward the Republican Party. Also, we take a look at gender, on how gender tells us about polls is that women tend to be more supportive on education policies, such as education, on gun control, on health care, as well as punishments on drunk driving. And that women tend to be less supportive on capital punishment, on war, compared to men. Now, I had all the students fill out a survey on abortion. Now, let's take a look at the screen here on abortion, over here on the screen on the internet. Now, I asked students, do you support abortion? Okay, it was a yes or no question. Do you support abortion? Now, here on the screen that I have about 11 said yes and about 10 said no. So it brought us to a 52% of students said yes and about 48% of students said no. So do you support abortion? Yes or no? And so the majority of you has said yes out of one more individual person. And also the second question is, do you support abortion when a woman has been raped, pregnant from incest, or suffering a medical condition? Because these things do happen. So when that happens, do you still support abortion? And now, as you can see, the public opinion has changed. So now it says yes, 18 students said that 86% do agree that when a woman has been raped, pregnant from incest, or suffering medical conditions should have an abortion, and 3% said no. So those students who said no, I'd be very interested in learning why that is the case and how you feel about abortion. Who influenced you to feel that way? Who are your agents of socialization? Was it your family? Is it your religion? Is it your coworker? Is it your friends? You know, how do you feel about abortion? And we talk about abortion because that is a very sensitive topic, especially when we talk about issues in political science. Abortion is one of those sensitive issues. Public opinion on abortion, 55% of people believe that life begins at conception. So 55% of people believe that life does begin at conception. Now, 21% believe that abortion should always be legal. And 56% of people say that sometimes it should be legal, and 22% believe that abortion should be illegal. This is public opinion on abortion, and I got this information from the Pew Research Center. And continue on abortion, 49% of the 6.3 million pregnancies that occur each year are unplanned. And as much as the 43% of the decline in abortion between 1994 and 2000, they said that the decline has happened because of the use of emergency contraception, also known as Plan B. So now since there's emergency contraception, now the abortion rate has actually decreased because of that. Now I have some comments here. This is from Rodrigo. Is push-pull like the old term for mudslinging, in which those who ran from president attack one another verbally? Kinda. It is kinda. So like push-pull is basically when they call another group of people and they say negative things about them. So it kind of could be set to that, but yes, so push-pull, it does happen, and when the next election comes, be aware of that. And also do your research too, because you don't want to necessarily believe everything that you hear, but you definitely want to, you know, be informed and make a better decision. Now, we're looking at a poll just a little while ago about having Miss Hillary Clinton run for president, and what are your thoughts about her being our leader soon? So this is from Michaela Coleman. Now, Michaela says, I don't think Mrs. Clinton would make a good president, not because of her gender, but because I don't agree with her views. It is very important to vote for someone who has similar views to yourself. Okay, very good, Michaela. Thank you for sharing that. So what are her views that you don't agree with? Can you elaborate a little bit further? You're welcome to call 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com, because I really want to learn a little bit more about that. Okay, now why don't we take a look at abortion rights? And let's take a look at that video. Let's take a look at anti-abortion activities. Let's take a look at this video, and then we'll come back.
With the politics of abortion and the March for Life, even the marchers themselves have changed dramatically in the 41 years since the Supreme Court's Roe versus Wade decision. Though now, one of the biggest questions of all is whether Washington should even be the focus, because the states are playing such a big role. The cold political climate in Washington and the freezing weather hit the March for Life and the anti-abortion movement with a double whammy today. House Majority Leader Eric Cantor summed up the news in the shadow of the Capitol.
Some of you have been marching for over 40 years and have endured many setbacks, including the recent expansion of abortion coverage in Obamacare.
Conservatives are looking to rally the base using the Affordable Care Act as a proxy in the abortion wars. On the 41st anniversary of the Supreme Court's Roe versus Wade decision, the anti-abortion movement is revising the message.
Our theme this year is adoption. There are sadly 1.21 million abortions annually. There are only 18 to 20,000 infant domestic adoptions.
And it's reaching out to the next generation.
I took a social justice class in high school, and we talked about abortion and just like the pro-life movement and stuff, and that's when I really started getting involved. This is my second time here.
Still, Republicans are fighting back against a message that they are waging a war on women. And this week, the Republican National Committee is proposing pushing back on the issue.
This war on women has wrongly been called the war on womanhood when the real war today is actually a war on motherhood.
James Dobson, a longtime voice of this movement, says Washington is taking a back seat in the conversation.
I think that there has not been a receptiveness to that message in a lot of the offices here in this city, and the states are where it's happening.
States now hold the power. In 2013 alone, 22 states enacted 70 restrictions on abortion, according to the Guttmacher Institute, which keeps track of trends in reproductive health policy. So a lot going on in those places.
Okay, so we're back. So I have a comment here from Katie. It seems that more and more polls would be done online today rather than on the telephone. Are we moving more in this direction? I would think so. We do have a lot of surveys that we can implement now online. I would just say it'd be kind of, we need to find a way to kind of find a way to get people to, real people to fill those surveys out and not somebody who's just, you know, continuing to fill out that survey. So maybe some type of access code. Everybody has a certain access code to fill out a survey or something of that nature so that there are not duplicate messages and that nobody's starting to skew the data. So I think that could be one way of going about it. Thanks, Katie. Anybody else, any other questions or comments, please feel free to call or text in your responses. So we're talking about abortion. Now, the U.S. Congress has barred the use of federal Medicaid funds to pay for abortions except when the woman's life would be endangered by a full-term pregnancy or in cases of rape or incest. So about 14% of all abortions in the United States are paid for by public funds. So virtually all, which are state funds, such as 17 states, including California, as well as Alaska, Arizona, Connecticut, Hawaii, Illinois, Massachusetts, Maryland, Minnesota, Montana, New Jersey, New Mexico, New York, Oregon, Vermont, Washington, and West Virginia pay for abortions for women who are unable to afford it. Now, an abortion can be costly, and someone who is going through a certain situation in their life and feel that they need to have an abortion and they don't have the money to pay for it, if they live in those states, as I mentioned, they can seek public assistance and have the state pay for abortion. And then if they weren't and not in those 17 states, the government would only be able to pay for their abortion if they were in danger of their life full-term, carrying out that full-term pregnancy or in cases of rape or of incest. So however you feel about that, I would appreciate your comment on this. And I do have another video, and a lot of you have showed so far that a lot of you are pro-choice. A lot of you are pro-choice, meaning that you do support abortion, and some of you are not pro-choice, meaning you are pro-life, so that you do not support abortion. So if you support abortion, you are pro-choice, and if you do not support abortion, you are pro-life. And I do have an assignment that goes with this, and I want to know of your agents of socialization, who have influenced you or what things have influenced you on how you feel about abortion. Now, I do have another video that I'd like to go into, and this is abortion rights versus Virginia. So let's take a look at that.
Virginia is drawing new battle lines in the decades-old war over abortion. But unlike most political battles over small business regulations, this debate finds conservatives arguing for more government control, while liberals are fighting for less. New healthcare regulations that were approved by the Virginia Board of Health in April place stricter regulations on clinics. Senate Bill 924 classifies health clinics that provide five or more first trimester abortions a month as hospitals. This means they must abide by the same standards as outpatient surgical centers instead of only complying to the standards for doctor's offices, which is their current classification.
This is really necessary in order to ensure that women are being treated with care consistent with their human dignity.
Mallory Quigley is the spokeswoman for the pro-life organization Susan B. Anthony List, a group that supports the new bill. However, women's rights advocates are calling foul. The bill includes building regulations from the width of the hallway to the size of the janitor's closet, things that would require expensive structural renovations and could potentially force the clinics out of business.
The legislation is clearly designed to do indirectly what they cannot do directly. So you cannot outlaw abortion under the United States Supreme Court precedent. So what these regulations do is try to impose such financial burdens on clinics that they are forced to close.
Larry Roberts is the attorney leading the attack against the bill. He is representing Falls Church Healthcare Center in Northern Virginia, who filed an administrative appeal against the state, claiming the regulations are unnecessary and unfair.
Physicians that are practicing in Virginia have been outspoken about the lack of medical evidence that deciding these legislations.
We shouldn't discount the importance of those building requirements. Back in Philadelphia, it was actually a Virginia resident who died when the emergency medical personnel were unable to navigate the hallways.
As tragic as one death is it enough to warrant new and costly regulations? From 1974 to 2011, there have only been three legal abortion-related deaths in Virginia, with over 1 million abortions performed. The risk is minimal, with less than 1% of abortions involving major complications. Falls Church has had zero deaths since its opening in 2002. The mandated renovations would cost Falls Church $2 million, a figure that could put them out of business.
In no other instance has the Board of Health applied new regulations to existing clinics or hospitals. It's always been for future facilities. So abortion facilities are being singled out as the only ones where new regulations are imposed on existing facilities that were built properly under the former regulations.
2 out of 20 abortion clinics in Virginia have already closed, citing financial burdens related to the regulations.
I think that's a very serious sort of foreshadowing of what could potentially happen.
28 other states have passed similar bills placing strenuous regulations on providers.
In so much of government, we hear people saying we need to reduce regulations and lower the burdens on businesses and help small businesses grow. All those principles are thrown out the window when it comes to abortion clinics.
Any sort of law that tries to restrict people being able to use their best judgment to make decisions about their bodies is like counter to justice and progress, I think, in the state of Virginia.
Okay, so that was a very interesting segment about Virginia and about how they deal with abortion. So I'd appreciate your comments on how you feel about abortion. I already have your responses here on the survey, but I'd like to hear from your own personal opinion on who influenced you to be pro-life or pro-choice when it comes to this issue of abortion. So if you can either, you can call 1-800-339-1193 or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com on how do you feel about abortion. So earlier we talked about Mrs. Hillary Clinton running for president, and I have a comment here. This is from Gabby. My fear is that people who do not really care about politics will vote for Hillary just because she is a female. Very good point. Yes, so that can happen. Just because she is a female, because of her gender, maybe individuals may want to vote for her because they want to see a female, a woman president. Okay, good. Thank you, Gabby. Anybody else? Any other comments about having Ms. Hillary Clinton as our next president, or about Obama's performance, or about abortion? Okay. So, into our next segment, we're going to be discussing political parties, and we'll probably end with that, and the reasons why people run for elected office. Now, I know I have a student in this class who's interested in running for elected office. I know I have at least one, and maybe there are a few other students who are out there who are aspiring to become more involved in their community. One of the things that I'd recommend for you to do is to first get involved at the very, very local level, which could be your school board or it could be city council. One of the ways to get involved into that is by first attending the meetings, being there, start meeting the people who are already on the board and letting them know that you are interested in running for office and how they can help you. So find somebody who's already in elected office who could be a mentor to you, and also find people who support you, people in the local clubs. It could be the local Lions Club, the local Kiwanis Club, any of the local Rotary clubs that are in your community and that are very active. I would suggest that you get involved in those clubs and start meeting the people so that eventually you can also be elected into elected office. But why do people run for office? Especially why would people run for elected office? So some of the reasons why people run are because of public service. They want to serve the public. They want to serve the common good, and they feel that their leadership position can do that. Now, another reason why individuals can run for elected office is also because of ambition. It's personal ambition. They want to see themselves in that leadership position. Also, two policy goals. Maybe something had happened to them on a personal level. Maybe it was gun control. Maybe it was abortion. You know, or maybe it was juvenile violence. Maybe something had happened to them on a personal level, and now they want to get more involved because they have been maybe a victim of crime, or maybe had known somebody who went through that similar situation. So now they want to stand up and speak about it. Maybe it could be medical care. You know, the list could go on. So maybe some policy goals that this individual has in mind, maybe more money for education, you know, less money on war. And also too, what happens is there's this term called the opportunity structure, which means that it's like a political ladder. So once somebody gets their foot in the door into elected office, like I said, at the local level, this will help bring that individual into a state office level position and then into a national office position. So we call this the opportunity structure because it is like a ladder. You know, once they get in at the first level, this could definitely help them bring them up to the second level and to the third level of them having into serving national office. So each move that they take, it does bring them to a more prestigious role and also brings them more closer getting to know the president and hopefully maybe even becoming president themselves. So those are the reasons why individuals run for office. And there could be also other countless reasons, but those are the main reasons that we have especially listed. Now, we talk about political parties. What is a political party? So defined is a political party is an organization designed to elect government office holders under a given label. Also, too, individuals with common interests seeking to gain power in government by electing officials to public office. Now, as I mentioned, individuals who want to get involved in elected office, it's best to join at the very local levels in the beginning to get yourself known, to gain supporters and whatnot, and then to take the next level up on the state level and then the national level. But at the very local level, at the school board, it's a nonpartisan, meaning that you don't identify with a political party. So meaning you could be a Democrat or a Republican, nobody would really know about it or really ask or really, you know, maybe they would, but, you know, it's not really such a key factor when it comes to the school board. So it's more of a nonpartisan type of deal. Then when you go into city council, same thing. They're not really running based on their political party identification. I mean, you can ask the candidate, but it's really more like of a type of a nonpartisan thing. You know that person's a Republican, and maybe you're going to vote that way, yes or no, but city council is its own way. Now when you go into the state level, like state assembly or state senate, the Democratic and Republican Party do matter, as well as at the congressional level and as well as the presidential level. And the two main political parties that we have here are the Democrat and the Republican Party. So the Democrat Party, as you see, the icon, the logo, is represented as a donkey. And for the Republican Party, is represented as an elephant. Or Republican Party is also known as the GOP, considered to be the Grand Old Party. That's what that stands for. And then you have the Democratic Party. So those are the two main political parties that we do have in this country. We do have many more that we'll talk about, but those are the main ones. Now, just a little while ago, we were talking about abortion, and I do have a comment here. This is from Leroy. I am pro-life because situations other than rape that cause people to arbitrarily end pregnancies. Okay, good. Thank you, Leroy. Thank you. So anybody else, how you feel about being pro-life or pro-choice when it comes to abortion, or how you feel about our current, our president's performance, or about our future president who may be elected into office? I'd welcome your comments onto this. So political parties. So the purpose of a political party is to not just win. Win is definitely a key aspect, but also to implement a vision. Okay, vision is the policy goals of what they want to see for that political party. So the presidency, definitely, both houses of National Congress, most governorships, majorities of state legislatures, their purpose is to hold office long enough so that their policies can get enacted into law. That's key right here. So once again, the purpose of somebody who's going into office is the purpose of their political party, and also the purpose to hold these types of office is long enough so that their policies get enacted into law. Now, as we talked about in the beginning of the segment, we were talking about SB 9, the Fair Sentencing Youth Act, right? Now, that is policy, and that ended up becoming law, okay? Now, the thing about SB 9 is it takes a long time for your ideas and your policies to get enacted, okay? That law in particular took 6 years here in California to get approved into law. And why does it take such a long time is, first of all, you got to write it up, you got to introduce it, and you got to get people on board to support you, like interest groups, right? One of the main interest groups behind that board was the Human Rights Watch, as well as Catholic organizations and other religious organizations. So one thing's first is to get a bunch of support behind that bill and to hopefully influence other people who are against that bill to support your bill, which is very difficult. And it's very difficult to introduce a bill into law, and it does take time. So SB 9 took a total of 6 years for it to actually come into law, which I'm very happy that we do now have that law, because when I was in Sacramento, that was actually one of the laws that I used to lobby for and support. Now, I have a comment here. This is from Ember. Ember, I definitely do not support abortion. I definitely do not support abortion 100%, especially when it's used as a form of birth control. I know many girls at school who have gotten multiple abortions. However, I believe in free choice, and abortion is a choice. I wish there was a compromise that could be made that could make both sides happy. Very interesting. Thank you very much, Ember. So, talking about political parties here, we just got started, but I'd like to continue this subject when we meet again next week. We will be recording next week, so stay tuned. And make sure that you do your assignments, because they will be due on the 18th, I believe. So make sure you're on top of that, and as well as your reading. So make sure you are reading the textbook. And just to note that the chapters for the textbook, the page numbers are at the bottom of the page. So make sure you are following the bottom of the page, because what you have is a textbook reader. So you have a compilation of different types of readings. So make sure that you, when you're following your syllabus, that you are following the bottom of the page, the bottom page numbers. Okay, so I hope you enjoyed this segment, and we will meet again next week. Thank you very much.